Unless you are extremely familiar with security cameras, it's pretty difficult to read the specs for a camera online and predict whether the field of view is going to be right for the area that you need to cover. The easy solution for that is to buy a varifocal camera that lets you dial in the exact field of view and zoom that you need for your mounting location. We're going to test these 10 varifocal PoE security cameras ranging from $110 all the way up to $1,100 to see if 10 times the price gives you 10 times the performance. Let's start out by taking a quick look at the camera lineup. The least expensive for $110 is the Reolink RLC 811A. Then for $159 is the Anki C800 Zoom. Then the $189 Lorex LNB 9282B. The $199 Amcrest VB2796EW. And the $237 Empire Tech T5842. Then, jumping up significantly in price, we've got the $449 Unify G4 Pro, the $709 Uniview 3638SB, the $779 Bosch Flexidome 5000, the $899 Avigilon H4A B01, and last, coming in at $1,100, is the most expensive camera we'll be testing today, which is the Axis P3248LVE. As I mentioned before, all these models are motorized varifocal, or what some people call zoom cameras, and all of them are 4K, 8 megapixel resolution, except for the Bosch Flexidome, which is 5 megapixels, because I added it to the video last minute and I couldn't find a source for the 8 megapixel version, since they're primarily sold by system integrators and not direct to consumer. For testing, to be able to compare apples to apples, I took a significant amount of time standardizing the zoom and aim of each camera, and I tested them in 3 different daytime lighting conditions and 2 different nighttime lighting conditions. Starting our test with daytime, full sun, no shadows, which should be the easiest lighting condition and should result in the best images. And starting out that with the easiest of those tests, I held up a sign at 50 feet, which at this level of zoom and 8 megapixel resolution corresponds to 200 pixels per meter, which is the lower limit for pixel density that should be able to identify a person based on camera footage. Ranking their image quality from worst to best, we've got this generally fuzzy image from the Avigilon, then the Amcrest was really pixelated and over-sharpened, next the Lorex was less pixelated but still pretty distorted, the Unify G4 Pro just overall lacked detail in my face and the sign. Then the Empire Tech was also extremely pixelated, but it did produce legible text. After that, the 5 megapixel Bosch also produced legible text, but was too blurry to be able to positively identify me, while the Uniview captured details in my face and also produced legible text. And so did the Reolink, but I thought the Reolink was a slightly more accurate representation of my face. The Anki did a great job preserving details without over-sharpening, and finally the Axis produced a pretty much perfect image from 50 feet and not only captured a ton of detail, but it didn't introduce any strange distortions, making it a clear winner in this first category. The next test was me running towards the camera, which tends to be a little bit harder for the cameras to capture a good image since the cameras use a sharpening algorithm to make non-moving or slow-moving objects more clear. In this test, the Unify G4 Pro was the least detailed, followed by the Avigilon, which still looked pretty fuzzy to me. Next was the Bosch, and then the slightly more distorted Lorex, and the extremely over-sharpened Empire Tech. The Uniview produced this strangely smooth image, and the Amcrest was pixelated again. We got a pretty good image from the Reolink, and then the Axis did really well, but I thought my face looked more defined and accurate in the Anki C800 Zoom, which takes first place in this test. Last is the most difficult test that I did in each lighting condition, which was another running test, but this time running across the image at 25 feet. At this range, the images have nearly 400 pixels per meter, which should be plenty to identify a person, so let's see how they did. The worst image came from the Unify G4 Pro, which looks like it tried to stitch frames together, but did a pretty bad job of it. Next was the Avigilon, which performed exactly like it has been, producing an image with no other problems other than it just being generally fuzzy. And yes, I did clean the lens and make sure the focus was dialed in, but this is just how it looks, I guess. After that was the Bosch, which again wasn't terrible, but it lacked details in the sign and in my face. Then the Amcrest was obviously artificially sharpened, but it still made a pretty decent image. And the Anki was also very accurate, but a little bit more blurry. The Empire Tech was way too sharp, but I do have to give it credit for producing a legible image of the 72-point font. And so did the Lorex, except without all the crazy over-sharpening. The Reolink produced a very HDR image with high contrast and legible 72-point font, and the Axis was also very good, but the sharpening algorithm made some errors in the sign and produced some strange artifacts around my legs. I thought the best image came from the Uniview, which was clear with no artifacts, although you can tell it's been through some smoothing algorithms to reduce noise. I repeated those same three tests at dusk with significantly lower light, which should increase the difficulty for each camera. Starting with the identification test at 50 feet, here are the results in order from worst to best. And the top three were the UniView 3638SB, the Realink RLC811A, and first place in this category goes to the Axis P3248, which produced a very natural looking image. Next, for the test running towards the camera, here are the results again from worst to best. And again, the top three were the Realink RLC811A, the UniView 3638SB, and the winner overall was the Axis P3248, which again produced a pretty much perfect image with legible 72-point font and great detail throughout. In these slightly lower light conditions, all the cameras seem to struggle in the cross-running test because they increase their exposure time, which also causes fast-moving objects to blur. This time, the top three were the Unify G4 Pro, the UniView 3638SB, and without a doubt, the best image came from the Axis P3248, which not only produced legible 72-point font, but also captured the most facial detail. And the last daytime test is to determine how well the cameras can deal with shadows, which is a feature that's called wide dynamic range, which lowers the brightness of highlights and it raises the brightness of the shadows. Starting with that 50-foot identification test, here are the bottom seven performers. And the top three were the UniView 3638SB, the Anki C800 Zoom, and as usual, the Axis P3248 produced the best image with no distortion and the most preserved details. For the test running towards the camera, here are the bottom seven. And the top three were the Anki C800 Zoom, the UniView 3638SB, and surprise, surprise, the Axis P3248 takes first place again with legible 72-point font and nearly perfect facial detail. Running across the camera's field of view in these shadowy conditions, here are the bottom seven. And for the first time, the Axis didn't make the top three, which went to the Realink RLC811A, the Empire Tech T5842, and the best image came from the UniView 3638SB, which produced a legible image of the sign without introducing a bunch of sharpening artifacts. So after that, let's look at some overall results from the daytime testing. For the scoring, I awarded 10 points to rank 1, 9 points to rank 2, and so on. If we combine all those individual scores, we can see the total score for daytime performance, which puts the Axis on top with a total of 28.3, the UniView in second with a 25.3, and the Realink in third with a 21.7. If we throw all those in a price versus performance chart and we consider the top performing Axis as a you get what you pay for, then the UniView does perform slightly above its price point, but not nearly as high value as the Realink RLC811A or the Anki Zoom. And having tested a lot of Realink cameras, this really comes as no surprise to me, since their daytime performance is basically unmatched for the money. But I do know that they tend to struggle at night, so let's take a look at those results. First, I turned off all the infrared lighting on these cameras and I kept my porch and garage lights on for a low ambient light test. Most of the cameras actually preferred to stay in color mode with this amount of light, but I did have to force a few of them into this night color mode. Starting with the still image test, this time at 25 feet instead of 50, which remember is roughly 400 pixels per meter, the Avigilon really struggled and clearly wasn't getting enough light to produce a quality image. The Unify did slightly better, but still lacked any facial detail. The Empire Tech's sharpening algorithm went crazy here and introduced a bunch of white dots throughout the image, while the Bosch was overexposed on the sign, but overall not that terrible. The Lorix had the same amount of facial detail as the Bosch, but also captured the sign, and the Amcrest had a legible sign, but a totally misrepresented face. The UniView did a good job with the sign, but lacked any facial detail, while the Anki got my face, but not the sign. The Realink actually did a great job on both the sign and my face, but not quite as good as the Axis, which did about as well as you could ask for. For movement going towards the camera, I decreased the capture distance to 25 feet to give the cameras a fighting chance, but pretty much all of them struggled. In fact, I don't think any of the bottom nine produced a good enough image to be able to be used in identification. In contrast, the Axis produced a great image with legible text and plenty of facial detail that could easily be used to identify me. Things were even more grim for the cross movement test at 25 feet, where none of the cameras produced any facial detail, but here they are anyways, from worst to best. In my testing in the past, color night vision just isn't as good for capturing movement as infrared night vision can be. So let's see if those tests went any better. These are also the only tests that I did separately since I needed to only have the infrared LEDs from the camera I was testing. All the other lights in my house were turned off, and all the other infrared lights for the other security cameras were disabled. Starting with a 25-foot, 400 pixel per meter identification, here are the bottom seven from worst to best. And the top three performers were the Realink RLC811A, the Axis P3248, and the top spot goes to the Empire Tech T5842, which, while a little bit underexposed, still captured the most detail, and with a little bit of brightness boost in post-processing, you can see how good the image actually is. For the test running towards the camera, you might notice that the stills are from slightly different locations and distances, and that's because I took the highest quality frame from a 10-foot area for each camera, which, as you can see, for the bottom seven performers, still wasn't all that great. But the top three performers here were the Lorix, which didn't perfectly capture the sign, but did a good job with facial detail, the Empire Tech, which again captured a lot of detail after brightening, but in this case, the Axis was the best performer even without any post-processing. Unfortunately, just like in the color night test, the results of the cross-running test weren't nearly as promising, and almost all the cameras produced a blurry mess, barely capturing my shape. And really, the only passable results came from the Avigilon, which at least captured my shape, and the Axis, which was blurry but had hints of detail that could be at least useful for things like matching my clothes to a description. I guess the moral of the story is, no matter how much you spend on a camera, it's hard to get footage of fast-moving objects at night. So if you're a criminal watching this, make sure to just move really fast when committing your crimes. Anyway, scoring the color night vision, again awarding 10 points for first place, 9 points for second, and so on, the Axis P3248 had a perfect score of 30 points. Second place went to the Amcrest with a considerably lower 21 points, and then third was the Lorix with 19. For infrared night vision, the Axis also won that category with a total of 29 points, while the Empire Tech had 23 and the Lorix had 21. And since for nighttime performance, it's not really important for a camera to perform well in both infrared and color mode, I took the best overall score from either the color or the infrared performance, which you can see here. And if we put those on a price versus performance graph, again using the Axis as a you get what you pay for solution, then here's how the rest of the competition stacks up for value based on their nighttime scores. So then, if we combine all that data, we get the most important chart, which is the combined score for daytime and nighttime performance, which I can use to give some final recommendations. First, if you're going to spare no expense, the Axis P3248 LVE is by far the nicest camera I've ever tested in terms of build quality, interface, options, and performance. It has an excellent desktop interface and phone app if you want to use it in standalone mode. It's ONVIF compatible, so you can use it with Blue Iris or any other NVRs that support ONVIF. It's got extremely advanced on-device person and vehicle detection. It supports MQTT, and it's fully NDAA and SEA compliant. The only negatives of the Axis P3248 are that it doesn't have a built-in microphone and obviously its price, which comes in at $1,100 each, which is probably more than you want to spend on your entire camera system, let alone a single camera. So moving on down the chart, the next highest performer is the Uniview 3638SB. But with a price tag of $709 per camera, that's probably still too high for most people. And honestly, if you're going to go all in and spare no expense, then you're much better off with the Axis instead. Then coming down significantly in price is the Empire Tech T5842, which is $237 per camera, and had a total score of 39.0, which was mostly the result of its high performance in the nighttime infrared mode category, which is why it gets my recommendation for anyone looking for a reasonably priced camera where nighttime performance is a priority. The Empire Tech also has a built-in microphone, it's got the widest field of view when zoomed all the way out, it's fully ONVIF compatible, and it's got on-device person and vehicle detection, which can be used to trigger ONVIF motion events if you have a compatible NVR. Unfortunately, the Empire Tech's daytime performance was just okay, and it was generally over-sharpened and pixelated, which was unfortunately not something I was able to correct by changing camera settings or changing the firmware. The other downside of the Empire Tech is that, like the Lorix and the Amcrest, the camera is manufactured by Dahua, which makes it NDAA and SEA non-compliant, which doesn't personally matter to me since I block all my cameras from the internet regardless of manufacturer, but it is worth noting. The Empire Tech can technically be used in standalone mode by recording to a removable SD card, but the app interface is clunky and your experience will be much better if you use it with a compatible NVR instead. After that, for just $159 per camera is the Anki C800 Zoom with a score of 38.3, which was the result of good daytime performance, but it took its nighttime score from the color night vision test, where in my opinion, it didn't produce great results. And if you're looking for a high-performing daytime camera and you're willing to compromise a little bit on nighttime performance, then I think the Reolink RLC811A is a better choice. Not only did the Reolink have the third highest daytime score, only behind the Axis and the Uniview, it also has a lot of other features that make it an incredible deal for just $109. The Reolink RLC811A has a built-in microphone, on-device person and vehicle detection, a great companion app if you want to use it in standalone mode, it has the option of using infrared or white LEDs, and because Reolink owns their own OEM factory, their cameras are NDAA and SEA compliant. In the past, I've reported that the Reolink 8 megapixel cameras don't work with Blue Iris, but I'm very happy to say that as of the January 2022 Reolink firmware update and Blue Iris versions 5.5.5.0 and above, the incompatibility issues seem to be solved. And after setting up the OnViv service in the camera's web interface, Blue Iris will automatically populate the correct settings for Reolink cameras. The downside of Reolink cameras is always the same. While its nighttime IR performance is fine for slow-moving objects, things that move fast tend to get disappearing leg syndrome, which is something that I unfortunately haven't been able to fix by changing camera settings or even by providing additional infrared light. Still, for 1/10 the cost of the Axis and less than half the cost of the Empire Tech, the Reolink RLC811A is an absolutely insane value as long as you understand the limitations of its nighttime performance. Down in the description, I have linked an unlisted YouTube video with all of the raw footage from my testing if you want to examine it yourself. Also down in the description are links to all the cameras that I tested in this video, which are affiliate links, so if you appreciate the time, effort, and money that it takes me to make a video like this, then using those links gives me a small commission at no cost to you. Thank you so much to all of my patrons over at Patreon for your continued support of my channel. And if you're interested in supporting my channel, please check out the links down in the description. If you enjoyed this video, please hit the thumbs up button and consider subscribing. And as always, thanks for watching The Hookup.